Greetings, everyone. Good morning. My name is Gigi Kwik, and I'm a senior associate at the Center for Biosecurity. And for those of us who are just joining us, I'm going to tell you a little bit about what our panel is going to be on. We're going to focus on trends affecting the life sciences as well as trends coming out of the life sciences. And often, when we talk about trends in the life sciences and security discussions, we focus on the dual-use dilemma that beneficent, perhaps even life-saving research could be misapplied for harm. But this narrow focus obscures many other national security implications that come out of the life sciences as a provider of jobs, food, energy, cool new industries that might now be developing in a garage lab somewhere that in 20 years we may wonder how we lived without, and of course medicines and vaccines. But as hard as it is for life scientists to believe, we are, you know, and as trendy as we are not the only trendsetters in the world, and there are other trends that affect us all and affect the life sciences and the contribution that the life sciences can make to national security. The changes in the economy, expanded access to information, global competition for talent and resources, trends in regulation, public regard of scientists and science in general, all of these things affect the role that the life sciences can play in national security. So with this broad focus, we are extremely lucky to have two life scientists with different perspectives to talk trends and how they affect national security. First, we are going to hear from Rob Carlson, who is a principal at Biodesic, an engineering consulting and design firm in Seattle. He is the author of the book, Biology is Technology, The Promise, Peril, and New Business of Engineering Life. He has experience with biological technologies in academic and commercial environments, and he has the distinction of having a garage lab himself. Then we will hear from Roger Breeze, who is the president of the Centaur Science Group, a countermeasures consulting group based in Washington, D.C. He was formerly the associate administrator for special research programs at the USDA Agricultural Research Service, and from 1987 to 1995, he directed the Plum Island Animal Disease Center in New York. So thank you very much. And Rob?
Thank you, Gigi. Let's see, I'll start with the garage lab, I guess. So for those of you who have been following this effort of mine, started in about 2005 when I decided I'd been following trends, which I'll talk about it in a moment, costs coming down, what was on eBay, and I had a particular problem I wanted to solve, a technology I wanted to redevelop that I knew worked, was published in Nature Methods, but wasn't commercializable, and I wanted to try to rebuild it in a way that was commercializable, and I also thought that I could pull this off in my garage, and that was 6 years ago now. So to take off on George's comments that it's overblown, I'm not so sure that it's overblown. It's just still really damn hard. Even if it's cheaper, it's hard. There's a we don't have Jason Bobe, unfortunately, here from DIY Bio, but there's something interesting going on there. I don't know how profound that change will be. So this is amateurs, some people who are truly well trained, getting into community labs or into garage labs, sharing what they know, teaching others, learning from others. I suspect the number of stories in the press about DIY bio exceeds by a large number the actual people involved in garage bio or DIY bio. That said, I know that there are a number of people who have kept themselves out of the limelight who are not associated with DIY bio precisely because the U.S. government has in past years not behaved very well towards people who were doing things legally in their homes. And I know a number of people who don't want to get caught up in that if the U.S. government changes its mind from its current path of being somewhat more permissive. So I'll observe that the second paragraph of the national strategy, paraphrasing a little bit, says, garage biology is good and necessary for the future physical and economic security of the United States. So innovation comes from garages. All the technologies in this room spent at some point in their development cycle in a garage. It doesn't mean you buy it from a company that's operating out of a garage now, but that's true throughout our economy. The Kauffman Foundation has recently demonstrated quite conclusively that all net job growth in the US economy comes from small companies and startups. Big companies lose jobs, small companies create them. So if we think we want a thriving economy, if we think we want a thriving bioeconomy, we need small companies. We need to allow and encourage that. We also need to allow and encourage that kind of participation if we want new technologies. It's true that biology has been more expensive in the past, and it's been hard to play that game, but because of exponential decreases in cost, exponential improvements in productivity, and all the stuff you can buy on eBay, it's now much easier to order a gene over the internet, as you all know, have it delivered to you, or as in my case, I didn't even want to be an amateur at protein expression and purification. So I had the gene that I ordered made by Blue Heron, had them FedEx that to a contract protein manufacturer. And the goal, lo those many years ago, was to have that contract manufacturer then send me a tube of protein. Now we've fired our fourth protein contract protein manufacturer because they keep sending me my protein, yes, but also a lot of other crap in the tube. So now we're bringing that in-house. And I am unfortunately going to have to become an amateur at protein expression and purification. And we'll see if I can build a business off that. The general trends that enabled me to pull that off, again, are dramatic changes in the accessibility of DNA synthesis, all of the labware necessary to manipulate proteins in my garage. It's actually not in my garage now because I wanted my garage back. But in the small commercial space where we are, it's a totally innocuous space. The zoning in Seattle is such that I don't have to do anything in particular to have a biotech lab in any given space. And in fact, the zoning in Seattle is such that I didn't have to do anything in particular to have a garage lab in my house. That's not true in every community in this country. There are two communities where that's still somewhat problematic, Cambridge and Berkeley. But everywhere else, as far as I'm aware, you can do whatever you want in your garage. Let's see. So to take this a little bit more internationally, as Tom mentioned, by my rough numbers now, so I spend about half my time building stuff in the lab and the other half of my time kind of trying to figure out how big the bioeconomy is and what are the implications of that, who's investing nationally, internationally, what are the security implications for the United States, that sort of thing. Trying to understand synthetic vaccines and how good or bad we are at making them, surveillance, that sort of stuff. So by my rough guess, the US now is about $250 billion in revenue from genetically modified stuff. That's drugs, crops, and industrial products. If I said biotech in most audiences, you'd think drugs are crops, and those are big. Genetically modified drugs in the US is about $70 billion a year. Genetically modified crops is getting closer to 100, depending on actual crop prices. So we're seeing those go up now. And also the regulatory status of, for example, alfalfa and sugar beets, which have come in and out of approval over the last few years. Industrial products, though, are 100 billion plus. It's very hard to say exactly. I'm quite confident of the biologics numbers and the genetically modified crops numbers. The industrial products are very difficult because many of those companies are still private and they don't actually have to report what their revenues are to anybody in public. I would say they could be as high as $120, $130 billion, but I'm more comfortable saying more than $100 billion. That sector is also growing much faster than drugs or crops, in large part because it's much less regulated. So drugs, a drug takes, you know, hand-waving $1 billion to get to market and 10 years, maybe 15 years, depending on what exactly you're talking about. Although biologics tend to be less expensive and faster than small molecules. Let's leave it at about that metric. That price point. New crops are 3 to 6 years, depending on how you manage that, and several $100 million. But industrial products could be $100,000 and as fast as you can get it out of your garage. If there's basically no regulatory barrier from making something in your garage and taking it to market, as long as you're not releasing a genetically modified organism or intending it for human, or rather marketing it for human use. Because remember, what the FDA regulates is not the thing itself, but rather marketing across state lines. And it regulates drugs and devices. It doesn't regulate treatments. So there's another angle we could talk about in terms of the future of these technologies coming into healthcare. as individual treatments rather than a drug that is regulated by, or a device that's regulated by the FDA. If it's a fuel, if it's a laundry enzyme, if it's a plastic, a new bioplastic, there's no regulatory coverage there whatsoever, as far as I'm aware. You can choose to have a fuel certified, but that doesn't have anything to do with regulation from the US government. So the point of that is, I suspect we're going to be seeing a lot more innovation from the bottom up through this industrial biotech route than we are going to be seeing in other areas. And that's why it's growing faster. So if biologics are growing at 10 to 15% a year, depending on the year, depending on what new drugs the USDA, or the FDA, sorry, approves, crops are growing roughly 10% a year at this point. Industrial products are growing closer to 20, and really dominating, in, as far as I can understand, the economic picture going forward. China, as best I can tell, these numbers have big error bars, but as best I can tell, is already at 2.5% of GDP from biotech. Malaysia is already at 2.5% of GDP from biotech. India is at only 0.25% because they just got started, but they're growing at greater than 20% a year. Pakistan is 1.5%-ish, something like that. And that's entirely due to genetically modified cotton, which until last year was illegal to plant, but nonetheless, last year, about 100% of the crop in Pakistan was already genetically modified in one way or another. The point of that is these technologies are all over the world, and there's an economic driver for them to be adopted, for there to be skills all over the world. It's not just here in the United States. Europe is a much smaller percentage of the GDP. They have about $20, $30 billion in revenues from genetically modified drugs. No genetically modified crop revenue to speak of. There are two crops that are approved for industrial use, but not for use in animals or people, or consumption by animals or people. What else do I want to say about that? I should probably wrap up here pretty quickly. Other than to note that it isn't just changes in DNA synthesis, DNA sequencing, protein production that are driving this broad proliferation of technologies throughout our economy, throughout the world economy. There are other technologies that are providing that same, or assisting in the pull, let's say. So we heard about information technologies earlier. GenBank, et cetera, happens to be, you know, full of errors in many cases, but nonetheless, lots of sequences there you can pull down to design a new protein or design a new genetic circuit to do something new. But it's also computer-aided design, computer-aided manufacturing, 3D printing. So if we think about regulation, and particularly this, the conversation we had earlier about regulating DNA synthesis, that regulation is predicated in part on the notion of a centralized industry that's easy to keep track of. But among the trends that I think are quite important here, if you look at the cost of oligonucleotides, so these are short single-stranded pieces of DNA, those are falling at a particular rate. The cost of genes, synthetic genes, from which are oligonucleotides, sorry, if you look at genes which require the use of oligonucleotides to fabricate, so you take these single-stranded pieces and assemble them into bigger double-stranded pieces, the genes cost more, right, than the oligos. But the cost of the genes is coming down faster than the cost of oligos. They're both exponential curves. What that tells you is that the maximum profit margin that these companies are eking out in this space is the difference between these two curves, very roughly, and that maximum profit margin per base is evaporating exponentially over time. It's not clear to me that the industry can survive as it currently exists with that kind of economic pressure. There are other technical pressures coming up. So my firm has two designs in-house for a gene printer already, a desktop gene printer. It's not in our business model to maybe go build one of those, but I think we could do it if we were given the money or if somebody wanted to do that. There are IP issues with emailing off your sequences maybe to China to have those fabricated there. So if you want a gene or a genetic circuit made and the cheapest provider is GenScript, let's say, and they do all their fabrication in China, then you just emailed all your IP to China and, you know, good luck hoping that that's secure. So there are many pressures, I think, towards actually decentralizing the DNA synthesis industry. And what that means is if you've built your regulatory expectations on top of a particular industrial structure, and that industrial structure goes up in smoke, so does your regulatory structure. And I don't think that people are carefully thinking through the implications of that here in Washington, D.C., or anywhere else for that matter. I have given some talks at the UN and the Biological Weapons Convention and the OECD lately, and when I phrased the problem that way, eyes open, some jaws dropped, and they realized that the world probably doesn't look the same as they'd been planning for. Just very briefly, the book is out. It covers a lot of paperback. You know, I'm doing my duty for my publisher now. It's paperback is coming. That's right. It's available on Kindle now. Hardback's hard to find, but paperback is here. And then I'm doing some work now that tries to internationalize the story that's in the book and try to figure out what the implications are down the road. If India is graduating the equivalent of 10% of the total U.S. biotech workforce every year, a workforce that's much larger than India's now, then the skills that we're seeing here in the U.S. are proliferating wildly in India, let alone China, let alone Malaysia, which had no biotech economy in 2005, right? They started from zero, and now they're bootstrapping very quickly. They want to be Singapore, or beat Singapore if they can. So I'll wrap up there. I'm going to finish up by preempting the next talk a little bit. I understand this is a PCR machine. Is it a real-time PCR machine or just real-time? Yeah. So my PCR machine is only this big, actually, the one we built.
You ready? Well, when Gigi called me yesterday and asked me if I'd prepare to step into the shoes of a sick warrior, I of course said yes, because I looked on the program and I knew that George Post was probably going to say all the things that I needed to say, but much better, and so I would just be in the fill-in position. So what I want to talk about today is what we perceive to be the current biological threats to national security. That's what we're all doing here. And to look into the future to anticipate and recognize new threats. Now, it's always a popular thing to start looking into the future. But as Winston Churchill once said, it's always well to look for the future, but it's hard to look further than you can see. Now, I'm going to try and do that nevertheless, because I actually have an advantage over probably all of you in this room. I was asked to do this very same thing for agriculture about 25 years ago. So I'm in the position of actually being able to tell you how that future actually worked out today, which is where my talk intersects with what George just told us. Tom was good enough to define national security and life sciences when we began. But it's worth starting off by saying, well, what do we actually mean by biological threats? Former Navy Secretary Richard Danzig always used to say that if you had 40 people in the room around a table and you wanted to talk about aircraft carriers, most of them had a pretty good idea what you were talking about. But if you had 40 people in the room and you wanted to talk about anthrax, you had at least 40 different ideas of what the concept was. So what I'm going to focus my remarks on today are the microbes and toxins listed as DHHS and USDA select agents. And I want to talk about the basics, diagnostics and vaccination, technologies that have been around since Louis Pasteur. And I'm going to focus on agriculture, which is something I know something about, which happens to be about 14% of the US economy, even though there's no one from agriculture on the list of attendees today. Which may actually sort of tell you something. The 1990s were a decade of rising anxiety and a small circle of people in the government, stemming from the disclosure of the former Soviet Union's offensive biological weapons programs, the proliferation of biological weapons expertise and technologies to other companies, to other countries that were unfriendly to the U.S. And there were numerous domestic and international terrorist incidents involving microbes and toxins. But it took the terrorist attacks of 2001 to get the Congress to actually act to establish legislation that criminalized the unauthorized possession and use of certain microbes and toxins that were considered to be exceptionally dangerous threats to our national security. Now, the select agent list has 38 viruses, bacteria, and fungi that infect humans, and 33 that infect livestock and poultry. And these agents are regulated by either DHHS or USDA, or both in the case of zoonotic agents. Now, 10 years ago, most life scientists and public health professionals were probably very surprised by the idea that a group of pathogens was considered so dangerous that their possession and use had to be actually regulated and criminalized in the US. But this was by no means a new concept for agriculture. Of the 33 USDA select and overlap select agents that infect livestock and poultry, five cannot be used as tools to attack agriculture. So I'm not going to talk about those. But the other 28 are all foreign animal diseases. That is, they're dangerous diseases of livestock and poultry that don't occur in the US or have never occurred in the US on a daily basis, although they're huge problems in parts of the world where they do occur. And one of the things that perhaps many don't realize is that for decades, helping countries respond to those diseases has been an important component of US foreign policy, particularly in the Americas, for foot and mouth disease control, which has been an enterprise that's been going for more than 60 years. Now, agriculture has long been worried about foreign animal diseases, whether you call them select agents or not. In fact, when Abraham Lincoln established the Department of Agriculture in 1862, one of the reasons was to help prevent the introduction of these dangerous livestock diseases into the US, even though, of course, at the time, people had no idea of the causes of these agents, because the first human or animal virus to be discovered, foot and mouth disease, wasn't actually identified until 1896. And the main concerns at the time, in 1862 and in that era, were foot and mouth disease, rinderpest, and contagious bovine flu and pneumonia, select agent infections, okay? Now, these agents have long been regulated in terms of international trade in agriculture. They're regulated by a body called the International Office of Epizootics in Paris, which is an element of the World Trade Organization. And the OIE establishes the scientific basis for proper regulation of trade internationally in animals and animal products, so that countries can't use fake phytosanitary trade barriers as non-tariff trade barriers to open trade in livestock. And from its early days, the OIE used to maintain a list aid of the dangerous animal diseases which provoked the most international regulation. And when the select agent list was put together in 2001, USDA actually basically just migrated the OIE list of pathogens from Paris to downtown DC to become the select agent list. So my point here is that the idea of select agents in the hands of terrorists were nothing new to US agriculture in 2001. They've been recognized as natural threats to agriculture for decades. In fact, 2011 marks the 250th anniversary of the first veterinary school, which was established in Lyon, France, after several devastating outbreaks of rinderpest, which was long the world's most dangerous livestock disease. Outbreaks which in Europe killed about 200 million cattle. Most of the population of cattle in Europe, actually at the time when it was introduced from Europe. Now, until 1956, the United States did not have a laboratory. In fact, this hemisphere did not have a laboratory in which these select agent infections of livestock could be diagnosed. In 1946, there was a huge outbreak of foot and mouth disease in Mexico. The only diagnostic capability was at a laboratory in England. Samples were sent on an ocean liner to England. By the time the results came back 6 weeks later, it was self-evident by the devastating spread of this epidemic all over the country that it was actually foot and mouth disease. The US got involved to help Mexico control this because our livestock producers were tremendously concerned the disease would come across the border. We spent $200 million at the time, 1946 to 52, which is into the billions in equivalent money today. It was a quasi-military operation that went on for six years. 16 people were killed in the control campaign, mostly by farmers who wanted to shoot the vets or people that were coming to inspect their farms and kill their livestock. Over 1 million cattle were slaughtered, and the slaughter rate was so great that actually the U.S. and Mexico had to adopt the radical technology of growing foot and mouth disease virus in the tongues of live cattle, killing those cattle and making that virus into vaccine, which was then injected after chemical treatment. That's actually how it was controlled at the time. So we didn't have a laboratory that could deal with these infections until the Congress in 1956 established the Plum Island Animal Disease Center as the U.S. Laboratory for Research and Diagnosis of 26 of the 28 agricultural select agents. The other two, which are avian influenza and Newcastle disease virus, were later on established in Athens and in Athens, Georgia, and in Ames, Iowa. So I was the director of Plum Island from 1987 to 1995. I was the director of the USDA research program at Plum Island, not the diagnostic lab, which belongs to the Animal Plant Health Inspection Service. Now, of course, given that there are 28 select agents and also other foreign diseases which are important that aren't classed as select agents, unlimited research funds, the question people always used to ask, which these days you'd call a risk assessment, what is the most important foreign animal disease or select agent infection for the United States? And the answer is the next one that occurs here. So 20 years ago, when we were faced with the question of, well, what were the current threats at the time and what were the emerging threats, probably the most significant conclusion in retrospect was that in terms of natural disease outbreaks from unintentional introductions, accidental introductions of disease into the country, the problem about the threat was actually not the pathogens, but it was the changes in agribusiness, public perception, and public opinion that had rendered the standard epidemic control measures completely unacceptable. Now, our role in research is not to set US policy about how these diseases are controlled. Our role in research, as other people's in research, is to produce tools and technologies that provide options for policymakers to adopt the most appropriate technology for the time. So let's just start off by saying, well, what was and is the US policy should these diseases be accidentally or deliberately introduced into the United States? Now, that policy actually goes back to Dr. Lancisi, who was the personal physician for Pope Clement in 1711 when rinderpest erupted into Europe and started killing all the cattle in Italy. He established the basis of veterinary response to these disease epidemics. The owners of sick cattle were obliged to report to the government. If you didn't report, if you were a clergyman, you were sent to the galleys. If you weren't a clergyman, you were hung, drawn, and quartered. So this comes back to some of like the stringent requirements that George would want to impose. There's precedent, you know, for our failure to respond to surveillance. The infected farms were quarantined. All the animals on them were killed, the in contact animals were killed, and they were either burned or they were covered in lime and buried in the ground. 1711, 300 years ago. And he kept on doing that till the outbreak stopped. It was as simple as that. Now, apart from aerial spraying of mosquitoes, if it's an insect-borne disease, our response today is essentially the same one as in 1711. It's not our policy to use vaccines before there's a disease introduction or to use vaccines to control the outbreak if there is an introduction. In fact, the U.S. does not have manufacturing capability for any of these foreign animal disease vaccines. Now, 20 years ago, we did not believe that these responses, which were the standard ones in the textbooks, would be supported by the American people in any significant epidemic involving mass slaughter of animals, millions of animals. Now, unlike late medieval Italy, we have single farms in the United States with 300,000 animals on them. Now, if you're going to shoot all those and burn them and bury them, that's going to be one hell of a pile. We have localities in this country where there's a million dairy cows within a 5-mile radius. Now, if you quarantine those right away, the question is, what are we going to do with all those thousands of gallons of milk, which actually are going to be produced until the animals are in the ground? What are you actually going to do? Pour it on the ground, pour it in the drain. What will you actually do? Some of these select agent infections infect horses. Are you really going to see the federal government seizing people's horses and shooting them, you know, without really any science? Is that likely? It didn't seem likely 20 odd years ago. Now, these very same responses would actually exaggerate a deliberate biological attack, were one to occur as a result of a biological warfare incident, although that's probably very unlikely today. Now, so far as agricultural bioterrorism is concerned, I've come to believe over time that it's only the way we've chosen to respond to these natural disease outbreaks in the past that allows terrorists to threaten us with them in the future. If we didn't have this theater of mass slaughter and burning and burial on the TV news every night, there really wouldn't be any point in a biological attack on agriculture. This would be completely irrelevant. So we could have a whole separate meeting on agricultural threats, and then, so in the interest of time, I'm just going to focus on the disease diagnostics and vaccines, just like I said. Now, many of these agricultural select agents are highly infectious. They spread quickly through an infected herd, and they spread quickly between farms and states with the movement of animals and animal products. A single pig infected with foot and mouth disease coughs and splutters up enough virus in a single day to infect 100 million cattle. Okay. So there's a huge amount. Now, if you have a state where you have 20 million pigs, that's an awful lot of virus being produced on a daily basis and being spread as an aerosol cloud. Now, we are uniquely vulnerable because of the structure of our agribusiness, which relies upon very rapid movement of animals, animal products, and supplies really nationwide. It's a highly profitable and efficient system, which was built on the assumption that dangerous foreign animal diseases don't occur here. So you don't have to think about what would happen if they did. Now, we saw in Mexico 65 years ago what happens when you have a slow diagnosis. So in 1990, it made no sense to us that diagnosis of these select agents in the United States could only be conducted on an offshore island off the coast of New York, which is 3,000 miles away, for example, from San Diego, California, which is near where the last foot and mouth outbreak actually occurred. Now, it was probably a dream come true to a farmer in California in 1956 that at last we had a place in the Americas where you could make such diagnosis. But in 1990, with California, the 14th largest economy in the world as a single entity, and the United States leading dairy state, it really makes no sense to say, if you want to diagnose these diseases, you have to take a sample on an airplane to Plum Island. The distance between San Diego and Plum Island is the same distance as between London and Baghdad. So you can imagine how odd it would be if you said to the British, you got to take these samples to Baghdad. It's the most efficient way of doing this. This doesn't make any sense at all. Especially when infection, of course, is spreading by the hour nationwide. So when you have an epidemic, time is the critical dimension. The more time you have, generally the more options, the more likely that one of those options will be favorable. So diminishing the time to confirm a diagnosis of a dangerous disease offers great advantages. And in the 1990s, we began to see that fast and accurate diagnosis could be performed close to the science of the problem using automated equipment that could be sent over with data that could be sent over the internet or monitored by experts at a distant site. Now, the most important diagnostic questions 20 years ago were, how do you distinguish animals vaccinated against foot and mouth disease from those that have had the whole virus infection? Because some people believe that animals that recovered from virus, from infection, some of them are still infectious. And this is used as a reason to vaccinate animals, not to vaccinate animals in an outbreak. And secondly, how do you identify animals acutely infected with these select agent infections on or close to the infected premises without a biocontainment lab? The first problem was solved by Juan Lubroth, then an APHIS graduate student, with Fred Brown in 1993. And he found that animals that had recovered from foot and mouth disease had antibodies to the non-structural proteins of the virus, where animals given modern vaccines didn't have those antibodies. And that's the basis for a commercial ELISA test that's been marketed internationally for many years now. The second problem was solved by an interagency effort using the Idaho technology, a portable real-time PCR machine linked by wireless to the internet to perform a real-time PCR analysis on the farm or close to the site of the problem. So by 2000, the real-time PCR tests were available on this device for seven or eight of these foreign diseases, including foot and mouth disease and rinderpest, classical swine fever, and others. Now, in November 2010, there was a meeting here in Washington about the state-of-the-art of animal select agent diagnostics that might be used by USDA in the event of a select agent outbreak. And the conclusion of that meeting was APHIS, and thus American agriculture, does not have a validated test to tell the difference between animals vaccinated against foot and mouth disease and those that recovered from infection. Real-time PCR tests have been deployed to the National Veterinary Lab Network for four diseases, foot and mouth disease, classical swine fever, avian influenza, and Newcastle disease. These are not confirmatory tests. The samples still have to go to Plum Island. Real-time PCR tests for two other diseases are still in validation. There are no validated laboratory network real-time PCR tests or other deployed diagnostics for the other 21 foreign select agents. And APHIS does not have on-farm technologies for diagnosis of individual animals, herds, or animal products. Now, we're talking here about real-time PCR and PCR in general, which has been technology that's been around for 20-odd years. Now, it's not that these tests don't exist. They've been invented by lots of labs around the world and validated, and they're used by lots of countries. What we're talking about is a situation where they're just not available to protect our agricultural economy, even in 2011, 10 years after we started with this. And this is really a massive and sustained failure to transfer scientific discovery to practice in protecting national security. And this failure is compounded by rapid advances in more complex diagnostic techniques that allow you to search for hundreds of agents at the same time in the same sample. So if we can't provide our first defenders with real-time PCR for more than four of the 27 priority diseases after 10 years, how on earth are we going to get them the enhanced diagnostic tools that can look at hundreds of threats at the same time, not just 27? Now, I actually I have here an example of a device. I have no financial interest in this. This is a portable real-time PCR machine, which is you're just going to get a quick course in how you actually do PCR, because it requires no intellectual capability, which is why I can do it. Here's a sample tube. You put a swab, you twiddle your swab in here and put the sample in it. You attach it to this tube here. All the reagents are self-contained and dried in here. You press the button, close the lid, and 45 minutes later, it gives you an answer. 60 minutes later, if it's a reverse transcriptase. That's it. That's the technology. That's the skill level you need. And you just put the test you want into that. Now, George has done a wonderful description of the future and the threats that we might face downstream. But since the early 1990s, we've had the ability to engineer new strains of foot and mouth disease that don't exist in nature, for which there are no vaccines. Foot and mouth disease is a picornavirus, like polio, which could be synthesized de novo. There are seven different serotypes for which vaccines don't cross-protect, and more than 70 different types out there in nature. Now, if we're not geared up to protect ourselves against these threats that have been around for 100-odd years, it's actually just an academic exercise to start worrying about other strains that might evolve in the future. So, I'll conclude by saying it's you know, this session is actually on life science trends that are worth watching. And the trend I've outlined today is worth watching, but it's unfortunately a very negative one. It's not that the science and technology for vaccines and diagnostics isn't there. New platforms are evolving by the day. But for 25 years, there's been a sustained failure to reduce this science and technology to real tools that have been tested in the real world and actually made available to protect the US economy. The president's tremendous goals, which have been expressed, you know, clearly for the first time, are really being let down by this. And so this is a trend that just has to stop. Thank you.
I think we have time for a couple of questions if people would like to go to the microphones. Rob, you didn't mention DIY bio, and I know there's a lot of hype on that, but do you think that some of this more, the more distributed capabilities of doing tests, of being able to circumvent the official, you know, officially verified tests and coupled with internet access, do you think that will change some of this trend that, you know, you can have the technology but no one will listen to it?
Eventually. So at the moment, people in the garage are as hamstrung as anyone else in terms of their ability to measure and respond and react to the world or alter the world for that matter. So I was mentioning, you know, our PCR machine, we collaborated with some people to build a convection-based real-time, not real-time, a convection-based PCR machine that consumes about a watt, runs off USB. So basically it's a USB peripheral for doing molecular biology. Could be real-time without a lot more work. There are other groups out there trying to enable PCR in a more distributed way. So, you know, one of the business models we thought about for the lava amp, as it's called, is to make it so cheap. It's a consumer electronics widget that all the parts come off standard fab lines. There's nothing particularly special about it. One of the business models was to make it so cheap that students would get one as part of their lab fees. So not only are high school students learning how to do PCR, they can take a PCR machine home and, you know, test their sushi or, you know, PCR crosswalk buttons and look for pathogens, that sort of thing. That's not here yet. It could be here. It wouldn't take a lot more work to get there. Unclear that the business case is entirely there for it, but nonetheless, the technology's coming along. There's a lot of hype in DIY bio. As I said, I think the number of press stories about DIY bio exceeds the number of people involved. But there is a great deal of enthusiasm. So I think there's a tremendous resource there. There's been some negotiation with the FBI about making sure that there aren't any incidents of confusion, I guess, about what people are doing where and what their intent are. And that's going to be an ongoing conversation. There was a period of time where I was extremely concerned about my own garage lab, and so I kept it quiet. And that's not the right response, right? We don't want to have a situation in this country where people keep quiet about what they're doing in their garage that might have some impact later on. We want them to feel comfortable to share what they're doing and not have guys in biohazard suits with weapons drawn knocking on the door.
Can I just add, I think there's a merge here between, you know, what Rob's been talking about. For 100 years more, diagnosis has actually been all about the process. Now, it's really just about the result. This particular machine here, you can link it to a cell phone, the one that Rob has just described, even smaller. So diagnosis now is actually a cell phone accessory, state-of-the-art diagnostic detection. It's a cell phone accessory. So if you look at what's been going on with disease reporting, official cumbersome disease reporting systems have really been circumvented by cell phone-based ones, ProMed, HealthMap, and all the rest of it, where people are providing all this information. Now, if you couple that cell phone, which there's 6 billion of them in the world, with a very simple device which feeds in to the cell phone with a state-of-the-art detection, you transfer that equipment. For the first time, it gives a person almost anywhere is the first person to turn up at the site of a problem, the ability to investigate, do a state-of-the-art detection, and report the information in close to real time. So this has been happening all around us, actually mostly outside government. It's actually been happening in the private sector, which is why this is all so important. And people no longer have to be dependent upon government actually giving them access to reagents. you got the reagent because you got a sequence on the internet, which is what George said, and you can actually do all this yourself. Probably going to have to do it.
I mean, that's kind of what gives me hope, if anything, that these decades-long trends might, you know, come to a close, that it will be a little bit more difficult to avoid the results of a test, no matter where it came from.
When I was a young faculty member years ago at the University of Glasgow, we said, as long as there's still death, there's hope of promotion. So I absolutely agree with you. There's still hope.
On that hopeful note, I think we're in the interest of time. We're going to wrap up this panel and on to the next session. But I'd like to thank our panelists very much for an interesting look into the trends that we're all dealing with, whether they're short trends or centuries old. So thank you very much.